N-fed half wave with a counterpoise, or an N-fed half wave with the counterpoise isolated away? Is there any difference in performance? Let's take a look next on a A3K on the go. In my video about N-fed half-wave performance using 50 feet of COAX as your counterpoise, as opposed to 20 feet of COAX as your counterpoise, I ended up finding not very much difference in the performance of the antenna. And particularly with RG316, shorter COAX means a lot less loss of power to the antenna. And those findings are also backed up by my maybe not so scientific experience of using my N-fed half-wave antenna with only 20 feet of RG316 coax and the number of contacts that I've made in some parks on the air activations. That particular video was very well received, which started a very large discussion in the comments, and a lot of people commented that they use a common mode choke right at the antenna to isolate the coax from the antenna and therefore have no counterpoise whatsoever. And I was wondering, what is the performance of N-fed half-wave when you have no counterpoise present? And is that an effective setup for the field? Then there's even more. I found that something very interesting when using at least this particular LDG common mode choke. So let's take a look at how I set up my test and collected the data, and then once again, the results of collecting all that data and what this choke is influencing in the antenna system. Okay, let's take a quick look at the whisper setup that I've used for testing here. I'm the laptop and running WSJTX in its whisper mode. And for the audio interface to my FT817, I am using a DigiRig interface, which you can't see because it is behind the computer. And then from that, coax out to the antenna. The antenna is my KM4ACK N-fed half-wave, and the transformer end is supported on the step-in fence post that is available from farm stores like Tractor Supply and Rural King and such. And the far end of the N-fed half-wave wire is on top of my 30-foot jack height telescoping mast, which is leaned into a tree in my backyard. And again, this is the same setup that I have used for all of my N-fed half-wire antenna testing. For connecting the common mode choke to the transformer of the N-fed half-wave, I've used a double-ended PL259 adapter, and that went to the SO239s on both the transformer and the common mode choke. And the coax is then connected to the common mode choke, and the choke is effectively isolating the coax as being the counterpoise. Okay, the first thing I did after setting up the N-fed half-wave is I put the UN-UN, as I would normally do, at the rig expert and swept for SWR. And then I moved the UN-UN to the antenna and again swept for SWR. And I noticed that these extra bounces and dips and the extra dip here as compared to when I have previously swept this KM4ACK N-fed half-wave with 20 feet of coax. And so here is that. And you can see I've got dips at 10 meters, 15 meters, 20 meters, and 40 meters. One up around, oh, I'm going to say around 30 megahertz, maybe even 40 megahertz. This is 50 megahertz or 6 meters. And so these have to be introduced by the common mode choke or the LDG one-to-one UN-UN. And even getting a nice SWR dip just below the 12 meter band, something that I was not expecting. Then I was going to run my whisper test with the UN-UN at the rig expert and then at the antenna separately. But after seeing these extra dips in here, I decided I needed to take a look at what the UN-UN was doing in terms of loss. And here we have a quick scan. So 20 feet of RG316, and this is the same chart that I had presented in my previous video, how much counterpoise do you need for an end-fed half-wave? And we're seeing a worst case is about 1.5 dB up at 6 meters. At the end-fed half-waves 10, 15, 20, and 40 meters, we're seeing a worst case of about 1 dB, which is about the same as you get with 50 feet of RG8X. But we're seeing sudden shots of loss with the unend both at the antenna and at the rig expert. Very, very similar, just a slight difference between them. And that is probably what is influencing those SWR changes. And we're seeing a peak of loss, you know, just below the 12 meter band. And again, we're seeing a dip in SWR, probably because the reflected energy is being swallowed up in that unun. Can we use the unun to effectively make a end-fed half-wave that's not resonant at 12 meters function at 12 meters, kind of lose the loss, lose the reflected energy coming back to the radio in the coax instead of going into the finals of the radio? Have to remember, my 817 is a very early edition 817, so it doesn't have some of the improvements that were made to the final amplifier in later production of the 817 and carried over into the ND and 818 models. Going forward, I ran Whisper, and I ran three cycles of Whisper with my FT817 at 5 watts. And the solar flux index was 172. A was high at 10, but the K index was only 1. And this was done early afternoon, so 10 meters might have already been starting to die off for the day. But on with the counterpoise present and then the counterpoise isolated out through the presence of the unun, very similar, just a few less contacts without the counterpoise. However, the maximum station that heard me was far less, almost 10,000 kilometers less. But the overall average distance of stations that heard me were pretty similar. So overall, these numbers are pretty similar between the presence of the counterpoise or not. Just the furthest out station didn't hear me that was picked up with the counterpoise, and the total number of stations were about 11 less. Not a big deal. The difference was even bigger on 15 meters, but still kind of similar. The same furthest out station heard me. Average kilometer of distance of stations that heard me was only about 300, 10% of the 3,000 kilometers. And the rest of the numbers are very, very similar. You know, really showing counterpoise or not, it's not making a tremendous difference. The unexpected part was that on 20 meters, a lot more stations, over 100 more stations heard me, though the furthest out station did not. And again, we still came down to about the same average. The minimum was actually a little bit better in signal to noise. But the averages were about the same. The standard deviation, the variance in the amount of signal to noise ratio that was heard amongst all the stations. Again, not a big difference. Jumping down to 40 meters. Very similar number of stations again. So not a tremendous difference. Personally, I was expecting to see without the counterpoise a lot bigger difference and a lot worse performance of the end-fed half-wave without it.
And honestly, at the end of all of that, I was not expecting those results. That isolating and completely removing your coax as your counterpoise, or really adding any counterpoise to an end-fed half-wave, that the performance really isn't that much difference. And in at least two of the lower bands, it's a little bit better. I'm not sure exactly how, and I haven't investigated yet, how the antenna has found the counterpoise, because there's always two halves to an antenna, the radiating part and essentially the ground part of the antenna. But that counterpoise portion of the signal could be traveling down that plastic fence post that I was using, which is black. And to get black in those kinds of plastics, there's usually a lot of carbon in the plastic mix. So it could have been traveling down that then through the metal spike at the bottom of that post and into the ground. I don't have any particular support that I can use that is completely non-metallic and non-conductive. Maybe something to look into in the future. The findings of the losses increasing with the LDG common mode choke very close to the resonant frequencies of my NFED half wave were unexpected. But also the dips in SWR around 12 meters and 80 meters, I was not expecting that. And something I'm gonna have to take a look at. Can I make one of these antennas that is only good on 10, 15, 20, and 40 meters also function on 12 and 80 meters with just adding a tuner in line potentially? This is my only common mode choke, so I do have a sample size of one. Looking at the inset picture of its internal assembly, it's just a simple winding on a toroid connecting the SO239s at each end, even though I got an adapter here, PL259 to PL259. I wasn't expecting that. So there is a video by K6ARK when he's showing the 1 pound POTA challenge where your radio, battery, antenna, and all the minimum things you need to set up a station to operate parks on the air and make at least one CW contact, one phone contact, and one digital contact, and then wherever, however many remaining contacts in modes that you want to reach the POTA minimum for activation, 10 contacts. And he was running one of his K6ARK NFED half waves with no counterpoise attached to it. Whereas I've built mine that I could attach a 20 feet piece of wire, which is more than appropriate for down to 40 meters with the NFED half wave that I put together. So something to further investigate. Will more counterpoise wires improve performance of the antenna? Will improve the directivity of the antenna, making it potentially less directional and more omnidirectional? That's one of the joys of amateur radio, besides getting out, making contacts, whether it being from home or out in the field, is that experimentation in the art of radio is encouraged by all of the national organizations that license us amateur radio operators. If you found this information useful, why don't you go ahead and consider subscribing to the channel? That really helps grow the channel, gives me further impetus to create more videos. Hey, I'm Mark, AA3K. I'm trying to help you make the outdoors your ham shack. 73, and I'll catch you the next time.